What's up, guys? You've probably noticed that all the height records are jumped on 7 and 8 meter kites in 45 knots plus. But why is that? Why can't we just take a 70 meter in 30 knots and jump just as high? So in this video, we're going to look at the relationship between lift, wind speed, and surface area, why a bigger kite isn't the solution, those friends who say, it was 60 knots, what size is best to break the 35 meter mark, my three main takeaways, and my dream job. Without further ado, let's get into it. The relationship between lift, wind speed, and surface area. First of all, what is lift? Lift is the force that happens perpendicular to the airflow as it comes over your kite. In other words, lift is what is making the kite pull you. When your kite is over to the side and you're riding, it's lifting, pulling you through the water or along the water. And when you're wanting to jump and you put the kite above you, it's lifting, taking you up. So let's look at the formula for lift. It looks complicated, but let's take a minute to understand it. So lift is equal to the lift coefficient times by R, the air density, times by the velocity, in other words, the wind speed squared, divided by 2, times by the surface area. So the lift coefficient is a complex factor that includes a number of variables, such as the shape of the wing and the angle of attack. So let's start by looking at the relationship between lift and wind speed. So here's the formula up here. If our kite has a lift coefficient of 1, has a surface area of 8 meters, the air density is 1 unit, and the wind speed is 10 knots, we will get 400 units of lift. So we're going to keep all the variables constant except for wind speed. We want to see how the lift changes as the apparent wind, the wind speed changes. So I've graphed this data and you can see it over here on the right. Notice that there is an exponential return on investment in airflow. If you can double the airflow, such as from 20 to 40 knots, you will quadruple the lift from 1600 units of lift to 6400 units of lift. Double the airflow and you quadruple the lift. Using this data, we can also graph the lift per square meter of canopy. And as you can see, kites become more efficient, lifting more per square meter as the wind speed increases. So now let's look at the relationship between lift and surface area. So keeping everything else constant, but just changing the surface area. So here's the formula and here's our data. Everything else is remaining the same. We're just staying in 30 knots and we're going to increase our surface area. So we've graphed this data on the right, and as you can see, there is a linear relationship between lift and surface area. If you can double the surface area, you will double the lift. Whereas with wind speed, if you can double the wind speed, you will quadruple the lift. So it makes sense that if you're trying to maximize lift, you would rather put your energy into finding stronger wind than increasing your kite size. Quick break for some exciting news. You can measure your jump heights and more for free using the phone that you have right in front of you. All you've got to do is get a waterproof pouch like this one and download the Surfr app for free today. I put the link in the description below and in the comments. Honestly, I'm so impressed with the Surfr app and I think it's the future. Be sure to try it out. Nyeowww! So why a bigger kite isn't the solution? So you might be thinking, can't I just take a bigger kite in that light wind and get the same amount of lift? So looking at our example data, you'll see that an 8 meter produces 8,100 units of lift in 45 knots. But you can also take an 18 meter in 30 knots to produce 8,100 units of lift. So you should be able to jump just as high with the 18 meter in 30 knots, right? Anybody who's ever ridden an 18 meter in 30 knots is either dead or lying to you. I'm not talking about 30 knot gusts either. I mean 30 knots of average wind speed. So I don't think it's possible to jump super high on an 80 meter in 30 knots. And here's why. The airflow that allows you to jump is not just the true wind. It's the sum of the true wind and the induced wind. Induced wind is what you create by riding fast and by moving your kite. The true wind and the induced wind combined make up the apparent wind, and this is the airflow that ultimately gives us lift and takes us off the water. So here's my theory why you shouldn't be able to jump an 18 meter super high in 30 knots. Firstly, I think we can all agree that an 8 meter moves faster than an 18 meter. Therefore, you will create a greater induced wind when you send the 8 meter up to zenith than you would when you send the 18 meter up to zenith. Because you're creating a greater induced wind, you're going to create more lift and therefore jump higher. Secondly, the amount of time it takes for an 8 meter to travel from 30 or 40 degrees to zenith is less time than it takes for an 18 meter to move from 30 or 40 degrees to the zenith and take you up. And I don't think that we can hold our edge long enough for the 18 meter to travel from 30 or 40 degrees to the zenith without losing our edge. But do you agree? Let me know what you think in the comments. Those friends who say, it was 60 knots! As someone who's ridden in 50 plus knots, I can tell you that it's not for the faint of heart. And anybody who's throwing around claims of 60 knots is probably over-exaggerating and should be questioned. So forget 60 knots. Let's make this more relatable. Let's look at 30 knots. I'm sure that many of us here have ridden in wind that's averaging 30 knots. And I've got to say, I think it's pretty strong. So how much airflow do we need, keeping all else constant, sticking with the same size kite, in order to double the amount of lift that we get from 30 knots? So here's the formula for lift. Let's substitute some values for the lift coefficient, surface area, and density. So with 30 knots and these values, we get 900 units of lift. We want double that with the same values. We want 1800 units of lift. So what wind speed do we need? So now all we've got to do is solve for V and it's square root 1800, 42.4 knots. 42 knots is twice as strong, double the strength of 30 knots. Can you imagine how strong 60 knots is? So what size is best to break the 35 meter mark? We've seen how high big air kites can jump on a 7 or 8 meter when it's gusting 50 knots or so. But how often do we see some of the big air kites get onto a 6 meter? As the data shows, the stronger the wind speed and the smaller the kites that we can justify getting onto, the higher we're able to jump, the more efficient these wings become. Whoa! Please take a second to subscribe to my channel. It only takes a second and helps me get closer to 3 million subs. So I think we're gonna see guys pushing the vertical limits of big air kiting on 6 meters. We just need to find wind strong enough to justify it. And of course, there's always a question of quality of wind because you don't want 60 knots of gusty crap. Also, there's gotta be a limit to how much wind we can handle. And having been in close to 60 knots, I do think that 60 knots is about that limit. So the three main takeaways from this video. The first is obvious. If you want to jump super high, you need to get into strong wind. My three favorite big air spots are Cape Town, Tarifa, and south of France, specifically Grisan or Le Cat. Mwah! Secondly, if you want to jump high, you don't just want to maximize the wind speed, you want to maximize the apparent wind speed. So we do that by riding fast with good edging technique. We've got a whole video about how to edge coming out soon. It's quite a difficult one, so it's been taking us a lot of time, but Nyeowww and I are working on it. Stay tuned. The third is that you shouldn't always take the biggest kite possible. I would much rather be lit on my 7 than lit on my 8. Get onto the smaller size you can be lit on. And by lit, I mean that when you're riding, you can take your hands off the bar the bar will be sheeted out and the kite is still pulling you. Oh yeah, I love that feeling. And of course, I'm injured right now and can't wait to be back in the water, but that's cool. I'm gonna make videos for you guys. And lastly, thank you so much for getting this far. I wanna tell you about my dream job. Over the past few years, I've studied, been an employee, and been a business owner, and I've had reasonable success at all of these things. I realized that if I wanted to be truly successful and feel fulfilled at the end of a long day of work, I needed to work on things that excite me and serve people in a way that I uniquely could best serve people. So at the start of the pandemic, I started bigairkite.com. We operate in South Africa, Europe, and USA, and we have a beautiful little shop right here in Cape Town. When you purchase on bigairkite.com, we give 5% of your purchase to one of our team riders, and you can choose which team rider you want to support. You can also get advice from one of our team riders by simply sending them an email via our website. Our three best qualities and reasons why you should consider purchasing from us are that you're gonna get great advice from people who actually f***ing send it. We've got the gear you love in stock and ready to ship, and we provide excellent after-sales service. Please be sure to check out our reviews when you check out the site. Shop on Big Air Kite. We are Big Air Kite Surfing. Now, I've tried my best to explain everything as simply as possible today, because if you can't explain it simply, you don't know it well enough. So although I did study computer science and I did take maths in university, I'm not a scientist. However, I did consult with a super awesome guy named Mark, who's studying engineering, and he helped me make sure that my understanding of Lyft was in line with how it does in fact work. So, I'm open to learning more if you've got any differing opinions to share, so please feel free to drop them in the comments.